This month on Images, see more highlights, both serious and fun, from month-long celebration of African American history and life. Chaparral Fitness offers exercise tips to help you stay in shape. And the anniversary celebration continues with more stories from COD's 50 years. All of that and more on this edition of Images. Welcome to Images. I'm your host, Rio Almaria, admissions representative at College of DuPage. Our program is a great way to stay connected with everything happening at your community college. To celebrate Black History Month, College of DuPage organizes and hosts a number of events in February, bringing together the efforts of students and faculty alike. The Black Student Leadership Conference promotes college and career readiness and is aimed at African American high school students. This year, over 350 students from 17 high schools attended the event featuring discussion panels, career exploration activities, and a college fair with representatives from 70 institutions.
I would say it's about you and about how we help you to succeed. But of course, that means it's all about what is in your head and what is in your spirit in order to do that. Because at some point in time, it will require us to step forward and say, I matter. I'm going to do everything that I can to fulfill my dreams.
Well, today is our fourth annual Black Student Leadership Conference at College of DuPage, and we're excited because we have at least 350 to 400 students here. And we open it up to our students so that they can explore what it means to succeed. We have panels today. We have a panel on college representatives so they can hear from college reps. And then we also have recent college graduates that come and sit down and share their experiences as well.
When you guys get ready to make one of the most important decisions of your young career, don't you want to check that school out first before you make that decision, right?
Well, from the students, I hear that they're engaged. They like the opportunity that there's been upwards of 70 colleges here for our mini college fair that they could visit and spend some time with. Our keynote speaker, Dr. Chandra Gill, she was exciting this morning, very provocative in terms of how she encouraged the students.
Have an attitude, settle your academics. Do not wait. Get it together now. Go to the best colleges. Make good choices. Hang around the right people. But I just want you to know, A, have an academic attitude. B, I need you to be brave. C, I need you to have character. Some of you today are going to get copies of my latest book. And I say in that book something that's essential. When we're talking about our people, I need you to know who you are.
For the Student Diversity Office to actually collaborate with admissions and outreach and reach out to over 350 African American students, man, that is the core of why I came here. And to see this develop in this way, it's been tremendous and it's a great opportunity.
Together we are. Together we are. Give yourselves a round of applause. Stand up.
Stay tuned. Later in the program, we'll have highlights from another Black History Month event, Apollo Live at the MAC, where students compete for large prizes. It's the college's 50th anniversary, and Images is joining the celebration with a special series of videos highlighting personal memories, opinions, and insights from the college's earliest days and on. In this clip, 50 Years of Stories follows the footsteps of Alpha One. The predecessor to the successful and popular Field Studies, embodies the college's experimental and adventurous approach to education through stimulating travel experiences and unique pairings of diverse courses.
what I've always known is that they were visionaries. These teachers and administrators, right from the very beginning, were very excited about alternative education. They had people from Outward Bound, they had offbeat high school teachers, real change agents, people that certainly wanted to push the education boundaries in many different ways. Tom Limblade, who was really an innovative educator, his role as the head of field studies, global education at the time, was to infuse alternative learning and all of these Outward Bound-like classes into the curriculum.
The overall atmosphere, I think, for everybody was, this is a very creative place and people, a place that really respects students. So if you had a proposal for something and you could make the case that it was better for students, you could almost always get it done, at least I was able to.
I think the field studies program is the crown jewel of the College of DuPage, because I'm a big believer in experiential learning, and I know a lot of teachers have gone in to propose programs that seem a little crazy, but they've always, you know, gotten great support. They've taken students to China, they've taken students to Russia, to Cuba, all over the world, and what a wonderful opportunity for students as well as community members to partake in.
China was one of the first of the long international trips we did. After that, I did 8 trips to Africa, and so I've been in through most of Eastern Africa, Southern Africa, and so we had, I think, 20 people on each one of those trips.
I took students to Yellowstone National Park. I was very involved in field studies. I was their librarian, too, for a long time. So we would do that, and we did bike trips. We did all kinds of crazy stuff. And that's one of the ways you can learn, is by doing things.
I had a student once who didn't really know what he wanted to do, and I advised him to take some of the field studies classes. And he took a class, he went up to Wisconsin on one weekend to go spelunking. And he came back and his life was changed. My God, this was incredible. I can't believe this. This was so great. And he's going on and on and on about it. That was one weekend and one field studies experience that he had. And from then on, he was involved in school and he found a focus that he was excited about. And that's what we were doing. We weren't just offering courses.
We did a couple of classes in Florida, joined to study seashells. We went to Nova Scotia, and I did Canadian literature, and he taught, again, marine biology. So I designed several other courses as well.
Leading study abroad programs to Canterbury and to Costa Rica, and I did a course on housing in Chicago. This is probably one of my strongest memories, where we looked at every level of housing in the city of Chicago. So we visited Dearborn Homes, public housing. We visited SROs, single room occupancy. And we were reading some of Studs Terkel's working and about the kind of socioeconomic diversity of Chicago and how it affected housing. And so we went out and explored it.
I ran a field study a week in Mexico, Mexico City primarily. Another one in Egypt and Greece, and another one in Greece and Italy, taking students for 2 weeks and having a set itinerary and lectures, and they had coursework they had to do.
I got involved with trying to come up with a field studies course where we would actually go out and chase storms. And this is something that had never been done at an undergraduate level. They had done it for research, but I thought, well, what a great experience. And the people here at COD, Pat Keir was the dean at the time, really encouraged me to try it and to be daring and to do new things.
In terms of diversity, not just in terms of the quantity of programs, but the quality of our field studies and the kinds of programs we offer, I just think is unparalleled. And I think it draws students here, but also it draws faculty too, because you have these incredible opportunities to teach, again, kind of for writers, teach, you know, connecting the word to the world.
The more direct experience you can bring into a course, the better the learning is for the students. And there's all kinds of research that backs that up. But as I said, lecture is probably the worst way to teach anything. There's no other program like that in the whole country, maybe in the world, that offers credit for direct experience like field studies does. There's nobody else that does that anywhere around here, for sure.
It was our job to take the program off campus, and we had a number of things that Dr. Berg believed in. He believed that we should take the program out to the community because we didn't have enough facilities to bring them in, and people wanted to go into their local neighborhoods to classes.
I was teaching everywhere, and we were all doing that. And they built a off-campus community of people who were going to these courses. And this was done through, Dwayne Ross did a lot of work on that. And we had all sorts of classes being offered at the high schools. And it was good.
We had large classes at Downers North and South and Naperville North and Central. And if they had an event, you know, like a regional basketball game, they might call and say, you know, we're going to need our parking lots. Can you move your classes for a night? And that meant a whole new situation. Didn't happen too often, but it did happen. And so we eventually got regional centers. We got a nice regional center, for instance, in Naperville, where we can hold a lot of those classes today.
We brought education to the students. Certainly they came here. We were glad to have them here on campus, but we were delighted to have them wherever they wanted to be.
The growth was really happening off campus. As I said, maybe 2,500 students to 10 or 12,000 in about a 10 or 12 year period.
Little did I know when school started in September that I literally, in the first week and a half, had talked to 200 people. I made a note of the calls that came in and the calls I had to return, the people who were anxious and wanted to know about this and make appointments. By the second week, I had lost my voice. I literally could not even talk anymore. There was a number of different regional centers, and the regional centers could then offer a core of classes which they knew the people in that area needed. All you needed to do was come to one of the centers. And then you could take a class, you could turn your homework in, you could take your test there, you could meet physically and personally one-on-one with the teacher without a classroom. Then that fed into an entirely new program where you didn't even need to leave your house. Because then video and audio courses, you could check them out at the library, take them home, listen to them then. You didn't have to stay there to do your work. You could come, you could take an exam and leave. And, you know, somebody would tell you when it would be marked.
Close your eyes, think about the best experience you've ever had in a classroom. Okay? Did it have anything to do with the classroom? Did it have anything to do with the chairs, or the doors, or the windows, or the floor? And it never does it? And I think that's the essence of what an education is.
You find a way to bring the college to the communities, and it worked.
Coming up next, 50 Years of Stories continues with a satirical play sparking protest.
Was a huge controversy. We put on a play called Sister Mary Ignatius Explains It All for You. This play was considered offensive to many people who are Roman Catholic. And this blew up.
It's a show that does, I don't know if you'd say poke fun, satirize. Anybody that was brought up Catholic would understand it, and not most people would not be upset about it. It doesn't really hurt the Catholic Church or anything like that big time, but it plays with it a little bit. You're doing the studio theater. And all of a sudden, people were complaining that this show was going on. And there were more and more people complaining, writing letters, and started to picket. And it was crazy. And McInnes, I met him in the hall, he said, what the heck's going on? And I told him, and he said, wow. He said, wow. I said, do you think I should drop it? Do you think I should just not do it? He says, no. He said, we should do it. He says, we can't create censorship here. We'll do what is right to do.
How are we going to respond to this? And we stood up for academic freedom. It was hard. It was hard. We got criticized. Bishop Imish from the Joliet Bishop came in Hal McAdish's office. And the three of us sat down and had a conversation about this play. And we worked through it.
So Christopher Drang did call me. The playwright called me and said, Craig, it's not worth all this conversation. You know, all this stuff going on. It's all right with me if you just drop it. I said, no, we're not going to drop it. So that was kind of interesting that I got a call from him.
The thing that I remember most is the fact that ticket sales weren't going very well initially, but all of a sudden with the controversy, every show sold out and they had to add extra performances. So, you know, controversy is not necessarily a bad thing.
And what happened is we got so many tickets being sold, we had to move it into the main stage. Which is very funny. The audience, the actors were very scared that the audience would, you know, would be there not wanting to see it or something. They were too much pressure on them.
But they also opened up dialogue in the sense they had panel discussions after the shows that gave people a chance to talk about what was good about the show, what was not, what the Catholic Church was about, what it was not about. So it turned out to be a wonderful learning experience really for the whole community.
Following each production was a panel discussion by, I think we had one priest there and several people on both sides of the issue kind of thing, but talking about it, and it wound up being very positive and created really a good discussion, I thought.
It was unfortunate there's a controversy, but academic freedom is important, and so we did pursue that, and they had our back, and that's important.
Back for a second year, the Black History Month celebration wraps up with the popular student talent competition, Apollo Live at the MAC. An enthusiastic crowd was on hand to enjoy the show and be amazed and entertained by the contestants.
Garbage set beside your garage. Got all you needed and there's no hope much. A love always came with emotional fees, but since you're heartless there was ease. You never needed her, you got your use.
Stay tuned for more 50th anniversary stories about the Escoffier Dining Room and the dedicated and loyal staff providing the support necessary to keep the college running smoothly for 50 years, right after this exercise tip from Chaparral Fitness.
Ball bridge. Lay down on the floor, face up, with your feet on an exercise ball. Extend your hips so that your body is straight. Use your arms to stabilize your torso by pressing your hands into the floor. Slowly lower your hips towards the floor, but do not touch the floor. Extend your hips again.
As the program grew, we needed an outlet for the products that the students were producing. We always had a little dining room. We served maybe 20 people at lunch. But as classes became bigger and more often, we needed outlets for the students' work. So when we moved into the SRC building, we had a small dining room. It was that, I'm going to say it was that glass classroom in the front where we served about 40 people. But again, exponential growth, we needed an outlet. So there was a common space in the building that really wasn't being used very often. And the coordinator at the time presented to the administration that it would be a better use of space if our students could use it for events. And we started off with just one day a week with lunch and one day a week with dinner. And then it got very busy and we couldn't keep up, and we were doing 70 people at lunch instead of 40. And then with the advent of the Food Network and other TV shows, we thought a demonstration kitchen would be in order. So a portion of office space behind the dining room was carved out to be a culinary kitchen. And we had AV installed where we had cameras in the kitchen that would showcase the students. It would be shown on flat screen TVs in the dining room, which was very new. Flat screens had just come out. The culinary kitchen was designed to showcase as opposed to produce food. So the cameras could be either on the showcase, they could be in the kitchen, they'd be shown as the diners were dining. The name of the room comes from Escoffier, who was the king of chefs and the chefs of kings. He was Cesar Ritz's chef at the turn of the century, and he set the standard for the modern kitchen and carried the level of service to its highest regard. So we thought he was an excellent name for our new space because that was our goal of excellence. And his image is quite stately. If you see the line drawings on the old menus and the old dining room, that he became our image.
Support staff we've had has been just outstanding. You stop and think about it. What's the first person a student meets when they come to the college? Some person in the registrar's office who is a support staff person. You know, they're not meeting the president or a teacher or anybody. And if those people aren't good at their job, you start off on the wrong foot, and then it takes a long time to recover.
I started out as a classified staff member. I was called a guidance assistant, and I worked in the counseling office, administering personality and interest inventories, writing information for a computerized information system we were developing for students at the time, and pretty much anything else somebody needed to have done. I was kind of a general all-purpose person.
I started out just, typing, and we would make up newsletters and send them out to the public. And I used to have to travel to deliver big packets of some of them to different facilities because it would have been so expensive to mail all of these newsletters, just trying to get the public, to inform the public what was going on.
I originally started as a cashier, went into payroll. We dealt quite a bit with the finance office, and we also dealt quite a bit with human resources. And if you ever ran into any kind of problems or something wasn't going right, you could always feel comfortable enough to ask for help, and everybody would be able to help you out with whatever you needed.
We all cared. Everybody cared. Everybody was trying so hard to make this place a great place. and I think did. And so there was great cooperation among us. We could all rely on each other. We could all help each other. I just don't remember people being uppity and, you know, oh, well, I can't do that. So everybody pitched in.
Yes, you have your education, you have your teachers, you have your faculty, you have your administrators and things like this. But what happens if your air conditioning is not working correctly in your classroom? What happens if the AV equipment that you've ordered is not showing up in your class at the right time?
Kind of the unglamorous jobs, but the jobs that are really, really important to get done to make a difference. For one of the referendums, we were stuffing and doing things for every night after work. And we would have big pizza parties, and we would all get together, and nobody complained. And we would sit sometimes 8, 9, 10 o'clock at night making sure everything got done. I think classified staff are very loyal and very proud of what they do. And even though they don't always get the recognition, I think they're one of the first ones to jump in and volunteer.
There's always so much happening at College of DuPage. Be sure to watch Images every month to stay on top of it all. Until next time, I'm Rio Almaria.